So, welcome to this panel. And this is a very new position for me to be moderating this panel. So, so please. Please be patient.
Signal that you're getting a TV show.
Yeah. Please be patient with me. So, actually, I've done this one time, and I can tell you in advance it was a catastrophe. So I try to do much better this time. I hope everything goes well because I have such a wonderful panel. The topic of our panel is beds are burning. Energy, climate, and geopolitics. So a lot of topics here. And together with me on stage tonight is Mr. Steve Clemons, editor at large at Hill, and some very interesting remarks you have made about also climate activism and how we are failing them.
Don't tell him yet.
No. Okay. Fine. You see, not doing well. Okay, try better. But anyway, then we have Mr. Charles Grant, director at the Center of European Reform. Then we have Mrs. Lykke, Friis, director of Think Tank Europe. And we have Mr. Geir, Westgaard, senior advisor at Equinor. We are very focused on the conventional war that is going on in Ukraine, and we sometimes forget that we thought that the next wars will be different. And we forget the hybrid threats and cyber threats that are there as well. Mark Galeotti has written that nowadays everything can be weaponized to fulfill different objectives without resorting to direct military conflict. The energy sector is a prime example of that. Stable energy supplies are vital for modern economies. The effects of the supply disruptions are felt across the whole society. And we are also used to have all the services and goods that are manufactured and provided with energy. And any disruption on this has also effect on our lifestyles. As yesterday, we had a very interesting panel, and Ivan Krastev said, their resilience is the pain you're ready to endure. And energy is definitely something that we have to discuss. We are seeing these dynamics also in the current EU debate about energy sanctions. As I have also stressed, energy might be expensive, but freedom is priceless. The problem, of course, is that in Europe, we have countries who have much better neighbors than we do. So this is a very difficult thing to explain. And we are starting to see energy more and more as a tool geopolitical tool, really. We were saying this before regarding Nord Stream 2, that it's a geopolitical project, not an economical one. But now everybody sees what we saw already years ago. But the big question is, of course, how can we really turn more energy independent, and how can we use this war to make the reforms that we haven't done before? And of course, then we talk about the green transition. So in the near and midterm perspective, we must diversify routes and find alternative suppliers, which is all very important. And the important part of this is the phase out of fossil fuels, but it's clearly creating new dependencies. We need to be very honest with this as well. One big challenge is how to bring people on board this green transition, because we have new challenges like increased need for raw materials, resources, and we also have the worry that nobody is left behind in this. And how do we talk about this? How do we make this story of green transition really a story that everyone can relate to? Geopolitics of energy will not go away with green energy, but it will just change and open new fronts of cooperation and possibly also conflict. I really enjoyed Mark Leonard's book called The Age of Unpeace, where he talks about how the connections we have with different countries makes us also vulnerable. And we are seeing this right now. Make sure that you're connected to friends, because the other side might also hurt you. And clearly, we see this with the Russian energy flows to European Union right now. But these crises give us also opportunity to do the necessary changes, or at least I think so, that we should have this opportunity window to use right now. The question for our panel is, how is energy and climate affecting geopolitics, and how we can really make the best out of it? First, I will give the floor to everybody on the panel and start with Geir, who is coming from Norway and bringing the perspective from Norway. Geir is a senior advisor of geopolitics and energy in Equinor, which I had the pleasure to visit in Oslo as well recently. And he's also a former Norwegian diplomat whose postings included Moscow, Vilnius, and Washington. So please, Geir, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Prime Minister, and it's good to be with you here. I thought I would offer a few initial perspectives on how Russia's war in Ukraine is impacting energy markets, energy policy, and by extension, the energy industry. I think it is important to note that something very important is going on right as we speak. Russia's role in European energy markets is being dramatically transformed. A process of decoupling is underway. And as a result of this, Europe will become progressively less dependent on Russian energy supplies going forward. Now, we can discuss the speed of the energy decoupling, but and it might be that if you, by some miracle, were to have a peaceful settlement or a peace settlement in Ukraine, that the speed would be slower than otherwise. I think the direction of travel here is quite clear. There is no return to status quo ante in European energy markets after the war. We are, in many ways, beyond the breaking point in an economic relationship that has become increasingly politicized, increasingly securitized over the last few years. And back to Mark Leonard, as you mentioned, energy connectivity used to knit Russia and Europe together. Today, it is driving us apart. And gone are the days of Wandel durch Handel, where we believe that mutual investments in energy would somehow promote peaceful coexistence with Russia. So we find ourselves in a very different world, and I see this as a process that is not going to be reversed. There may be other aspects of what is happening as a result of the war that could be reversed. I think this is a fundamental shift. Russia stands consequently to lose most of its share of European coal, oil, and gas markets in the years ahead. And the EU in particular will wean itself first of coal, second of oil, and third of natural gas. And this decoupling will be remarkable in its swiftness. What do I mean by that? I mean that it is likely to be completed by the end of the decade. Now, you might say that is not exactly as quickly as Brussels would like to see this process move, but I think we have to be realistic. It will be, at times, difficult, costly, and time-consuming for Europe to come up with alternatives to Russian energy. Take natural gas as an example. At the moment, there is no ready alternative gas supply available for perhaps more than 30 to 40, maybe max 50% of what the Russians are providing right now. So the speed will, in my view, be remarkably swift, but I think perhaps not as swift as everybody would like to see this process. And I think it is also a feature of the energy scene right now that Russia, which used to be considered an energy superpower, today, as a result of sanctions and embargoes, cuts a much more diminished figure on the global energy scene. We see how Russian oil production is continuing to decline as you face challenges in different markets, as Russian oil storages fill up, as fields, production from different fields is shut in, as you see an increase in decline rates in the Russian oil fields, and as the service industry, the oil service industry, increasingly leaves Russia. Similarly, Russia's ambitions to grow significantly its market share in global LNG will also be cut back as a result of sanctions and as a result of the embargoes we are now seeing. So finally, a few words about how I think this is likely to impact the energy transition. And then I'm talking about the energy transition in Europe. I think there it's much more difficult to have a clear view of how the global energy transition will be impacted by the war. But some of you may know that in the industry, we talk about energy policy being about trade-offs between security, affordability, and sustainability, which basically means that you have to strike the right balance between secure, cheap, and green energy. This is what we call the energy trilemma and managing the energy trilemma. For most of the last 50, 60 years, energy has been about security of supply. For the last two, three decades plus, it has also become increasingly about environmental concerns, climate concerns. So what we are seeing right now is that the climate concerns that have dominated energy policy of the last two decades are now have to compete with the security of supply and affordability concerns that stem from the war in Ukraine and the ensuing energy crunch. And the question then becomes, what does this mean for the energy transition in Europe? I think we are likely to see a process whereby we see the transition decelerate at first and then accelerate. Deceleration in the short term as Europe focuses on all of the above, to reduce dependence on Russian gas, and then acceleration longer term as Europe concentrates, doubles down on investments in renewables and low carbon solutions so that they can hasten the overall exit, not just from natural gas and from and other fossil fuels. One final point. It will be easier for governments in Europe to sell the energy transition when they can do so on national security grounds. But as this audience knows better than most, security is not free. And securing a stable supply of low carbon energy going forward certainly won't be free either.
Mm. Yeah, thank you. We can go back to discussion later on, but this is just a side comment. For me, it is surprising. I thought that, you know, when this war started, then it would be very clear to everybody that we have to get rid of the dependency and also move with the green transition. And now we have the story to the people that they everybody should understand that we need this, but it didn't happen like this. But we can come back to that later on. So I will turn to Steve Clemons, who is editor at large, The Hill, from United States, highly experienced American journalist, and before was editor at large at The Atlantic and senior editorial roles at the National Journal Quartz. A vast experience in covering economics and international affairs, and recently been focusing heavily also on the U.S. climate policy. So please give us the transatlantic view.
Well, thank you, and great to be here. And what it doesn't say in there is that I'm not an energy expert. I am a political watcher, and you know, I turn out to be one of the few chroniclers of a man who sort of seems like right now, and I mean this as a joke, sort of the alternative, you know, the co-president in America right now, Senator Joe Manchin, who happens to be chairman of the Senate Energy Committee. I write a lot about Senator Manchin and his decision-making and approach right now, and would be happy to get into that with folks if they'd like to talk. I you know, Geir is a genuine energy expert, and I think framed things very nicely. Where I think I would depart from him right now, and I'm just going to be very real with trends I see and offer provocations and probably overstating a few of these things. But I think it's important to realize that this time is a fragile moment. And when we kind of look at a lot of the biases and direction that we have built into our energy and environmental future, I think a lot of those first principles are going to be rethought in this time. When Geir said that he sees a deceleration right now in, you know, the era of green energy and green transition, it'll be, you know, decelerated for a while and then a big acceleration. I see a deceleration and then probably another deceleration and then maybe another deceleration. And I can share why. And I don't want to be politically correct in this, but I sort of see that right now you have a real fundamental tension, and I see it in Washington every day. There's clearly everyone would love to see a cleaner energy, a more sustainable future. But reality has a bad habit of coming in and helping you to come very comfortable with the illusions that may be part of this equation. And let me just share some of the things, some provocations that we can chew on later. I wrote down here that the Biden administration's strong early enthusiasm for curbing fossil fuels and investing heavily in renewables sort of rammed into a coal mountain before the Russian invasion. I mean, so many of the elements of the energy shock that we're having today were made before the current global geostrategic tensions that we have. And that is in the political reality that mathematically there are 50 Republican senators, 50 Republican senators and 48 Democratic senators and two independents who call themselves independents. And maybe if you put Joe Manchin in there, he's really more of an independent than a Democrat anyway. So you've got a situation of a real standstill when it comes to policy. Joe Manchin's from West Virginia, which is a strong coal state, but you also have a lot of other Democrats that are riding along behind his wake. I would say if you look at New Mexico and other places, there are oil and coal states. If you look at John Hickenlooper, who's a senator from Colorado, he's got a big mix. So you have a lot of what you call all of the above energy senators who the frustration with the environmental community is not that they're for all of the above, but it's that they're not more forcefully against oil and gas. And I think that's where the politics is today. And right now, those mathematics are not likely to get better. Mm-hmm. When we come into the November race, which is in 7 months, so Joe Manchin's particular point of power may disappear if the Democrats gain a seat or lose a seat, because one of the parties will have a real majority. But there's also a chance that you may be back to a 50-50 in the next in this November 2022 election. And in that case, Manchin's power of the moment will continue, and he's very committed to a balanced climate and energy approach. He's committed to put forth a bill that looks at all of the above, and we'll do that. We can get into details. But I just want to say that the Green New Deal and a lot of the progressive enthusiasm around energy transition and a green energy transition is an illusion that died very quickly, though people did not want to realize that in the United States. The Russian invasion of Ukraine has just put a dagger really definitively in the heart, in my view, of that course. Russia, also before the invasion, also showed with Ukraine and also Europe a willingness to weaponize its own energy leverage in the world. And we were unprepared for that. And so hopefully that weaponization of energy supply will do it. When we're talking about what Geir said, and I largely agree with him in terms of what may happen with decoupling, there's another element there, which I always find fascinating, is that no one ever wants to talk about nuclear. But you can't achieve global climate targets, in my view, mathematically, without robust participation of nuclear. Germany gave up its nuclear. We're probably paying a price today for Germany walking away from nuclear supply, mm-hmm. nuclear power plant supply. Russia today makes 47% of the world's annual nuclear fuel needs. That's equivalent to the United States and Europe's entire annual demand. So if you were to decouple from that tomorrow, and there's no strategy in place in the United States right now, as of this moment, to basically begin dealing with that national security dimension. It was, I thought, pretty hypocritical to pressure Germany and other nations on Nord Stream 2, while in the fact we had this undercurrent supply that Bill Gates' next generation nuclear supply is dependent on the Russians. Mm-hmm. Right. So there's a very big disconnect there. We talk a lot about national energy independence in the United States. It's something that Donald Trump liked, that I think that there are many people that celebrate that moment. Certainly they think it's important. It's also a real illusion, because if you're a superpower in the world and you're working with allies, as many of us are working today amidst the invasion of Ukraine, backstopping allies with energy support and supplies is vital. So you can't just think about your border, which makes you, when it comes to countries like Saudi Arabia, the UAE, Qatar and others that are so important, among others, you know, Norway, et cetera, in building supply. The other element of here that I find to be an illusion is every decision we take today, if we go to Prince Turkey and talk to his friends and his family sort of running the place, you know, and say, let's amp up production. You can't just do it overnight. There's a naivete in the energy discussions that supply can be quickly brought on. If you go to Qatar and say, well, Qatar has gone to backstop Germany with a lot of LNG or other nations in the world, there are not enough ships to move it. So when you're looking at the kind of talks about decoupling energy or increasing production and supply, there's a missing discussion about the missing refineries, the missing ships, the missing containers, all of the missing infrastructure to actually change that. It's got to become part of the discussion. And as you build that supply and you build in that investment, do you think you're going to give it up just because we're going to, you know, the next round after, you know, on the next round of the Paris Climate Accords after? There's going to be a built-in invested set of resources and attentions that you're not going to wake from. This is a new generation of investment in oil and energy and gas capacity that I think is going to be with us a generation, even though Geir may be right, in the long, long transition, maybe you get some of this. I've mentioned nuclear energy very clearly. Part of that picture needs to be discussed, and I think there will be some efforts. Some of you know Dan Poneman and others are trying to lead a way to look at U.S. greater, deeper investment with U.S. domestic or at least allied expansion of nuclear fuel production. The other thing that I think is an illusion in there, which I'd like to put out there, because we often talk about solar, wind, biofuels, and others, and again, to scale biofuels, we're nowhere near where that needs to be. So we talk a lot about wind. Now, the Europeans are pretty well set up in wind, but in America, the entire wind industry, even before the invasion, even before the energy surprise, even before the failure to build back better, was hanging by a thread. So you talk to the wind industry folks, you go to talk to the CEO of GE in the United States, and the wind industry exists through tax credits. And there's kind of this shell game that goes on with tax credits in wind, which is companies kind of, oh, I don't say they cheat, but they sort of build their liabilities and credits near the expiration of those credits. And so the wind industry goes in these up and down fluctuations dependent on the provision of those credits. And right now, we're in a down cycle for those. Those credits have not been renewed with the collapse of Build Back Better. And you've had a staggering collapse in wind-generated energy in the United States, and the industry is gasping for air at this moment. But as those credits come on, even if they were to be passed in a new climate energy bill, the tradition is they've got time to do it. The wind industry in the United States may disappear, is what I'm saying. It may be, maybe some of you are more expert, and I've talked to a lot of folks in GE there. I think there are just some interesting challenges we have in terms of improving what the government incentives and credits are in working with the renewable sector. And we sort of think that these are, you know, all fungible and that this energy division is permanently there. I can tell you it is hanging by a thread, and it's another dimension that we need to think about. I do think that there are big changes going on in oil and energy and gas and the fossil fuel production because the public wants it. Sometimes a bigger driver than what the government does on these geostrategic issues is that when you kind of look broadly at most rational, reasonable people, they want to live in this future. So when you see what the investments have been made, it's largely come from that driver. The ESG movement, et cetera, has made a difference to those in the oil and energy sector, and I wouldn't discount that. But Dan Fried said something that sort of haunts me, and I think he's right. And I'm going to overstate this again for effect, but there's a kind of... Let's just be honest. There's a very dark, pugnacious nationalism, jingoistic white nationalism that's become a bigger part of the American political scene, and they've either intimidated or seduced other parts of the political system to acquiesce. Not everybody is a white nationalist in these areas. They don't really give a damn about Ukraine. They really don't give a damn about global international engagement. They would be fine to withdraw within the walls of the United States and let things go where they will. What they don't like is discomfort, being put out of their way, being told the government's over them, and paying high gas prices.
Exactly.
And so, interestingly, to not further build the ecosystem that is supporting that, environmentalists have an awkward choice of whether they step forward and become more realistic with the balance between and all of the above energy and environmental strategy, less strident, less Green New Deal, more a broader equation as a way to buffer what Americans feel. Because right now, if you raise the cost to them in their minds, you fund, which we've seen in other parts of the country, but just America's not in a place right now where it feels good about a lot of what's going on in the world. Mitch McConnell is trying to change that. He just arrived today in Ukraine, meeting with Kiev with a couple of Republican senators. Rand Paul was not in that group, right? There were other folks that were not part of that group. And it would be a mistake to underestimate, I think, how America and many Americans feel that global engagement has been a bad deal for them. That being the cop for the world, being engaged, they fought the Cold War and China won in many of their lives as they look at their savings and homes and various, struggles that they've had. And so that is a real part of the system right now. And I think trying to find a way to, that in climate environmentalists have to figure out a way to figure out how to not further increase the toxicity that drives that political movement. And I think that's very hard for them, and it's why I think that everything is likely to get worse. Yeah. I'll end there.
With that optimistic note, let's come back to the conflict between the energy and climate issues. What do you say? There are people who are very worried about their big energy bills, and I don't understand how that doesn't meet the climate targets, because the renewables are cheaper, and how they don't make the connection there, that actually supporting the green transition also takes down your energy bills. But we can come back to that. So now I'm turning to Lykke Friis.
I would just say real quickly that there may be different, but in the United States, that's not true. That renewables still overall run more expensive than a highly subsidized oil and gas sector, but nonetheless, the subsidies that are implicit aren't felt by those people. Mm. And right now, say in West Virginia with coal mining, the price of coal is booming. So you have all the negative incentives at play right now to make that green energy transition stall. And as I was talking to Prince Turkey earlier, as you get in and try to solve a lot of the market provision problems in refining or LNG support or the ships, that's not going away. Mm-hmm. So that will continue to expand.
Yeah. So we move to Lykke, Friis, who is a very experienced climate voice in Europe, former Danish Minister of Climate and Energy, who also chaired the UN Climate Conference in Copenhagen in 2009, also former member of Danish Parliament. You are definitely helping us not to lose the sight of the climate transition. So it would be very interesting to hear from you.
Please. Prime Minister, thank you very much. And also thank you to the organizers for the great song that we started out with, Midnight Oil, sort of reminded me of my high school days. So thank you very much for that. Although when I was Minister of Climate, Energy and Gender Equality, my theme song was Jimi Hendrix's Electric Ladyland, as you can imagine. So, and for me, I mean, energy policy has always been security policy with a capital S. I mean, that's a... I mean, why on earth should we as Europe basically send tons of money to regions that do not share our values? That has always been my starting point of this overall discussion. And yes, you could say, why on earth did we realize that before? I mean, you can make that argument. And you can also say, have we realized it enough? But I think we do have a new driver with regards to our overall energy and climate policy in Europe at the moment, where, I mean, who would have thought that we at the European Council in Versailles could actually agree upon that we should become independent of Russian fossil fuels. I mean, you can say that it should be faster and so forth, and we're still debating sort of the time frame of it, but I agree with you. I mean, it's für immer, to quote Annalena Baerbock, the German foreign minister, when she went to Kiev the other day. So, or as Midnight Oil, what do they sing? They sing, the time has come. So that is basically sort of the starting point of this discussion. I'll limit myself to 3 points from a European perspective. First of all, and it's very banal, but the cheapest energy in the world is simply the energy that we do not use. I mean, so it is energy efficiency. And that is a part discussion, and I also remember that from my own time as Minister of Energy, you always go out there and you see fancy new wind turbines or fancy new investments or whatever, new sort of brilliant scientific stuff, but you forget the most banal part, energy savings. And you could also put that in a security perspective. So on Twitter the other day, isolate Putin, insulate your houses, right? I mean, it's so banal, but why on earth are we not doing it? I mean, even a country like Denmark, which is, I guess we could say, a front runner with regards to green transition, we do not have a binding goal with regards to energy efficiency. So I would say that for Europe, for the EU, now that the Commission comes out with its plan next week on Wednesday, REPowerEU, I mean, energy efficiency should definitely be part and parcel of that plan. And one should also sort of have more ambitious goals than the one that's come out so far, that we should limit sort of our energy savings by 9% by 2030. I think we can do better than that, sort of from a purely security perspective. And it also points to your triangle there, because it's affordable and it's also sustainable. Mm-hmm. So that was my first point. My second point, talking about security, now that we all realize, hopefully in Europe, that that energy policy is security policy, we should obviously not sort of stop with Russia. We should make sure that we do not just exchange one dependency with another. I mean, embarking upon a shopping spree to various parts of the world that we do not necessarily share values with. I have a very, very nice neighbor, Norway, also in real life, but that's not, if you look upon sort of where we have sort of these shopping sprees taking place at the moment, not necessarily the case. So I think that will be important, and it will also be important from a European perspective, and there are differences to the US, But if you want to have public support for green transition, I mean, it's not enough to use the Putin argument, then you also need to use the climate change argument. For the younger generation, yes, of course, if you also take my own country, Denmark, I mean, they're extremely worried about the security situation. They are very much involved with regards to the war in Ukraine. But for them, to be very serious, for them, the core challenge for their generation is climate change. And last time I checked, there were no changes with regards to science when look upon climate change after the 24th of February. The opposite. I mean, the clock is still ticking with regards to the need to limit our carbon emissions. So I think if you want to have support in Europe, you need to combine the arguments, obviously both having climate change, but also the security argument. Finally, this panel is inspired by midnight oil and beds are burning. One could also draw maybe a little inspiration from another classic, from good old Kermit from the Muppet Show. It's not easy being green, he used to sing. And for some, that's definitely the case. It's not easy being green. I mean, for Denmark, it's rather easy because of the history we have and sort of long sort of almost, I mean, several decades, even going back to the 70s, we all agree that, well, we have to sort of embark upon this green transition. But if you have a different energy mix, a different history, well, it's not that easy. And that, I think, was a very, very important message by Ivan Krastev yesterday, that there'll be differences in how much pain we can endure and how much pain this will unleash when we want to become independent of Russian fossil fuels. So I believe that we would also have to embark upon sort of thinking about the box with regards to how do we then share that burden. I mean, European solidarity with regards to energy policy will also be important. And two brief points there. I mean, who knows? Maybe we'd have to look into a greening of the growth and stability pact. That could be one option. Another option would be to look into a climate resilience fund, whatever may be modeled on the new generation Europe. Something I think will have to be done, because just look upon the election in France. It was, even though Emmanuel Macron won, I mean, Marine Le Pen had a pretty good election, sort of drawing attention to purchasing power and so forth. So I think we are in for a challenge there, confirming Ivan's point from yesterday, if we do not think outside the box.
I totally agree with you. The risk is there that when the energy bill goes up, then the values are out of the window the first sight. Going to our last panelist, Charles Grant, who is leading geopolitics expert from the UK, founded the Centre of European Reform in 1996, and it's its director, works on, among other topics, Britain's relationship with the EU. How is that going, by the way? We are looking particularly forward to his thoughts about the impact of reducing energy dependencies from Russia on Europe and its, of course, political dynamics. So please, Charles, the floor is yours.
Thank you. I'm happy to talk about Brexit for half an hour if people really want, but I'd like to come here for a holiday from that. So I'm on holiday now from Brexit for a few days. I'm basically in accordance with everything that Geir said, but I'm a bit more, I have some of Steve's pessimism to leave in what Geir said. I think in the long run, the war will help Europe to reduce its consumption of energy and the amount of carbon it emits. And I think the short and medium term may turn out to be rather longer than we would wish. Firstly, just think about the consumption of the production of carbon outside the European Union. Europe is hoovering up LNG supplies from all over the world that used to go to poorer countries that can no longer afford to buy LNG. I just saw recently that Pakistan is importing huge amounts of Afghan coal and burning coal when they used to burn LNG instead. So I think this is one thing to be aware of, that Europe's impact of what it's doing on the rest of the world is considerable. Within Europe itself, again, obviously some countries are burning more coal than they used to and burn more oil than they used to make up for the shortages of gas. And one thing I picked up when I was in Brussels last week was that a lot of people in Brussels believe that Fit for 55 will have to slow down. I know that Commission doesn't accept this point, and Commission officials told me they were going to speed up, not slow it down. But The energy crisis basically means that consumers are paying much more for energy than they used to. They don't like doing that. Politicians are sensitive to that fact. And things like the new commission plan to extend the emissions trading scheme to transport and to homes will mean, if it's really done, will mean that consumers have to pay more, and they don't want to do that. So at least 10 or 11 or 12 countries of the 27 member states seem to want to slow down quite a lot of the Fit for 55 measures. I think this is a factor to consider. Then there's the politics of it. To echo something that Steve already said about the US, I mean, I think people who live in the Brussels bubble don't realize how hostile many ordinary voters are to these green measures that most of us in this room support. In Britain now, wood-burning stoves have been banned. You can't drive a diesel car in central London. Holidays to Spain are getting more expensive. People don't like these changes. And Nigel Farage understands this. Nigel Farage is the man who got Britain out of the EU more than any other single individual, probably, because he forced Cameron to hold a referendum on Brexit. And Nigel, I've actually talked to Nigel Farage about this. And Farage sees this, and I think similar populists in France, Germany, Italy, and probably many other countries too, see this as the next great song for them to sing. They've often sung the song of hostility to immigration, hostility to the European Union. And I think hostility to do-gooding Brussels liberal greenery is one of their next best tunes that they will be singing for the coming years. And there'll be more support for it than perhaps people who spend a lot of their time in Brussels realize. I mean, back to the Gilets Jaunes, it's now 3 or 4 years ago, but what were they complaining about? The speed limits in rural areas and the price of diesel fuel. So I think we have to watch out for this the right-wing populist picking up a new tune. Just a brief word on Russia. I mean, I think we've talked about the impact of all this on Europe, but I mean, the impact on Russia we haven't talked about very much. Mm. I mean, the Russian economy, even before this recent crisis, was in a pretty dire state. Standard of living had gone down for average Russians in the last 10 years. Now, in the very short run, Russia is actually doing okay because the ruble has gone back up to where it was because of, I guess, capital controls and the extra money that we're all sending it because the prices are so high. Russia gets about, by some estimates, $1 billion a day from the European Union for energy, which perhaps another thing we can come on to later is should the EU impose an embargo? Isn't it better to impose tariffs, as some think tanks like Bruegel have proposed? Mm. And there's a strong case for tariffs. Perhaps we can come back to that later. But back to Russia for now. I mean, the Russian economy is going to be, in the long run, cut off from Western technology, Western trade, Western expertise. It'll be hit by the brain drain. A lot of the best Russians have found ways of leaving the country. In the long run, the Russian economy will stagnate. And it's inevitably going to stagnate. And Russia is going to drift slowly into the Sinosphere. It has no choice. A lot of Russians don't want this to happen. They don't like becoming China's junior partner in a geopolitical struggle against the West. But they really have no choice, because politically and economically, Russia is just too weak to stand on its own. They need the Chinese, however uncomfortable that is for many Russians. I think Russia is drifting into the Sinosphere. And I think beyond the scope of our panel, I think that there is some sort of new Cold War emerging, but with Russia and China and their friends like Iran against some of the rest of us. The question I don't know the answer to is to what extent this political Cold War, which I think is happening already, leads on to an economic decoupling. I think, you know, both the Chinese and we Westerners hope we can have our cake and eat it. We hope we can be politically hostile to them without losing all the economic benefits that tie our economies together. But that's about something we can come back to later. Just some final points. One final point for now. I think there's a difference between this the oil shock we're seeing now and the oil shocks of the 1970s. I'm old enough to remember the oil shocks of the 1970s. I did my school exams by candlelight because there were power cuts because of the oil shocks, and the coal strike didn't help either, but a lot of it was oil. Because in the 1970s, there was really no alternative to hydrocarbons. We had to pay a lot of money to the Middle East countries who had a lot of the oil that we needed. And there was a massive economic and political shift in geopolitical weight towards the Middle East at that time, away from Western countries. It's a bit different this time, because there are alternatives. In the short term, there is, of course, a shift, I suppose, to oil producers. But given that as we've been discussing, and as Geir said, in the long run, Europe is not going to import any hydrocarbons from Russia at all in a few years' time. It'll import less from other parts of the world as it introduces green energies and green techniques. In the long run, it's not so good for the oil producers because we're learning how to do without oil. So I'm not sure. The greener our economies become, the worse for the oil producers. So I mean, it's not just the Gulf, but it's also, you know, Nigeria, Mozambique, Angola, Venezuela, Iran, all sorts of countries are going to have to find other ways of earning foreign exchange. And some of them are well placed to focus on solar energy. And I guess a lot of Western aid for these countries in the future will be focused on trying to help them make the transition to new sorts of energy that are greener energy that's good for them and good for everybody else. China does rather well out of this, I think, though, because China, of course, being a net energy importer, won't suffer too much from these high prices. From the green transition. Of course, it dominates battery production, but also wind turbine production and solar panel production. So China could do very well in the long run. So I'll stop there for now, but let's come back to this idea of whether, finish on where the thing I mentioned earlier, these tariffs instead of embargo. The trouble with an embargo, it's on or off. You either import or you don't import. Well, if you impose a tariff on Russian energy imports, you can fine tune it to increase the pain on Russia or increase the incentives on ourselves to introduce new sorts of energy production.
To take from there, I have actually proposed to the European Council to have an escrow account so that you pay for Russian oil and gas, but you pay to a separate account saying that it is your money, we owe you for the oil and gas, but we pay to a separate account and it can only be used for rebuilding Ukraine because you clearly owe to Ukraine by destroying it, and so we already have a money. So I'm a lawyer by profession. I always know that it's better to have something than to demand something. And we can discuss whether it's 5%, 10%, 15%, but then we would kill, three flies at the same time. One is that we already have the money to reconstruct Ukraine. Second is that we take away the funding of the war machine because 40% of Russia's budgets come from the hydrocarbons. And the third is that, we send a signal to Russia for every building you destroy, you're going to pay for this and we already have your money. And of course, the problem some say that if we stop paying for the gas, then they will turn it off. But we are not stopping to pay for the gas, but if we pay to a separate account and you can use it this...
Well, I like that idea, because then the trouble with the embargo is it puts up the price, which is good for the Russians. They get the higher income, and it's very painful for us. So I think your ideas are very interesting.
This is what I'm pushing. But
and how far are you with getting support for you?
I have some support, but some support is still missing. Working on this, and it was interesting how, coming to the tariffs, then some argument was from the Russian side that if we don't get all money, then we don't deliver. But what we have to understand, it's a pipeline gas, and coming back to the book of Mark Leonard, it's a connection. So you can also hurt the other side of the connection because it's a pipeline gas. You can't sell it to anybody else who is connected to the pipe by the pipe. So this is also the other side of it. But I want to come back on some of the issues, actually very many issues, and I see that time is running away very fast as we take questions from the audience as well. Steve, you mentioned nuclear, and I think this is a very big question because what we see when Germany is shutting down nuclear power plants and we have all the interconnections, then we see that all the power is moving, electricity is moving towards Germany. So we clearly have a problem that we don't have enough. And when we talk about independence of Russian gas, then the question is, of course, will Nord Stream 2 be dismantled, or is just on a pause and we go back to business as usual? But I think we can't overcome the question of nuclear, really, in order to cover the energy consumption needs that we have. So what are your thoughts on nuclear, really, in this picture?
Well, I mean, I know this will offend some people, but I thought at the time when Germany gave up its nuclear plants, it was, from a strategic point, incredibly reckless, because it created burdens on its allies and supporters if, in fact, you had something unfolding as you did. You know, what I find fascinating about Putin, Russia, you know, when you listen to Dan Fried's speech, look, Putin or Russian misbehavior, given the fact that the geopolitical tensions didn't get largely resolved. We can all applaud NATO expansion, but you had an area where you were clearly going to have a battle of whoever us is versus them again, and so that history would eventually repeat itself. And so as a key part of that, there's hardly anything more significant in geostrategic calculations in energy, and so to create that structural dependence in Germany, I thought was very, very bad. But it was a win, so-called, for those who, you know, my friend Reinhard Budikoff or other people in the Green Movement saw this as a win. But I found it as something that was hostile to the kind of balanced energy and environmental approach that will largely get us all towards a cleaner and more sustainable future. But now we have a situation where the nuclear industry has a taint. Obviously, there are a lot of, you know, problems with the nuclear side. But we don't talk. That's why I was committed to raising nuclear. I also wanted to raise the fact that Joe Biden expanded oil and gas leases in the United States in response to this. We don't talk about. But even the Biden administration that came in, probably with the kind of, you know, most robust clean energy engagement. You know, with Garrett, I don't know what Equinor is doing, but are you out of expanding oil and gas leases? Are you developing any more oil and gas, or you're not allowed to talk about that?
No, I'm happy to talk about it.
But I mean, I just think it's the interesting question that in this moment of crisis, even on this stage, we've hardly talked about the fact. I mean, you talked about security of supply, and we talked about cost, but the fact is that if you're going to buffer and kind of deal with this, which is, you know, I think we look to our Saudi friends and Emirati friends and Qatari friends and others to backstop us a lot. But it means that in this moment, you're going to of decoupling, you're going to have a massive expansion in the oil and gas sector, and no one wants to talk about it. And the question is, how do we make it fit with the other pieces, right? So I think that's where we're at. And even in the United States case, on the green side, the renewable side, there's no possibility in the next 20, 30 years to scale any of those to the degree. So there's just sort of a mathematical naivete in a lot of this. Mm. And I think Germany was a good illustration of that with the kind of blind spot I saw on the nuclear side.
Yeah, but actually, many of you touched upon this topic as well, you know, the energy or the competition for the energy resources, really, and also some of you said allies backing other allies' energy supply in the case where we have really competition for the same resources, and I find this also very intriguing, or actually worrying, I would say, that if we start to compete for the same resources with our friends, and we have seen in COVID already, you know, when the crisis hits, it's my country, it's my energy, and
my masks.
Yeah, it's my masks. So we see this kind of protectionism, which actually is detrimental to all the good relations that we have with the like-minded countries as well. So, Geir, can you talk about the oil more?
or gas,
or what are you?
No, I'm happy to talk about both, but I think just one point I wanted to make, because we tend to forget that right now Europe and the United States are pretty much aligned, that we need to curtail Russia's energy revenues so as to prevent Russia from using these revenues to prosecute the war in Ukraine. That is a fairly recent development, And that is a fairly unique experience in transatlantic relations. Mm. Because over the last 50 years, I would say that energy security, and especially Europe's reliance on Russian energy, has been a source of contention across the Atlantic. We forget that the Kennedy and Johnson administrations initially opposed the Druzhba oil pipeline. Mm. Then we all remember the Reagan administration and the Trans-Siberian gas pipeline. And the only way they relented on the American side was the Europeans, the Western Europeans, committed to not going about 30% dependence on Russian energy.
Yeah. But this is a valid point, and now when we are trying to get rid of the Russian dependency, are we creating new dependencies that might hurt us the same way? Mm. And are we making those, you know, connections or dependencies on our friends or allies, or is it somebody who can hurt us the same way? So, Lykke.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that is obviously a challenge. But my point was another one, going back to the nuclear issue. I mean, in Europe, I mean, we do have the debate now, obviously, on nuclear energy. I mean, just take the old decision by the European Commission to say that gas and nuclear should be considered sustainable. So we have shifted already before, I would say, before the Russian situation. My own country, Denmark, I mean, we also decided, well, we should look into gas. I mean, not just to say, well, let's just not get the gas on the ground that we have, because now the situation is a different one. But nuclear, as you also alluded to, obviously also has challenges, right? If you look upon the German situation, if they really wanted to prolong them, I mean, that's going to be very sort of expensive, apparently, and then they will also have to find the uranium somewhere. And where do you get the uranium these days? I mean, not necessarily countries that you would like to buy your uranium from. So I mean, that, I guess, just puts in a situation where you need to have an energy mix where you draw upon many different kinds of sources to reduce that dependency that you would otherwise have.
Okay.
And of course, there will be a scramble for resources. There will be competition for resources. And there will be maybe some coordination on the part of the Europeans, maybe some coordination across the Atlantic. But I don't think we should expect too much in that regard. There will be a scramble for resources. There's no doubt about that. The big question is, to what extent will the Americans be able to come to the rescue of the Europeans? How much will the Americans be able and willing to produce? We see a situation now in the United States where increased energy prices could raise questions about how much energy do we actually want to export. It's not long, many years ago, that the Americans lifted their crude export ban. And you could see challenges down the road, given the right administration in Washington. Mm. And that would be a huge challenge for transatlantic energy relations going forward. Right now, most of the slack from Russian gas is likely to be picked up by US LNG. But how is that likely to look going forward? And then if you look at the Russian side of the coin, the question is, how much will China be able to come to the rescue of Russia to help ensure that Russia becomes an energy superpower again? And there, I take Charles' point that that Russia is drifting into the sinosphere. But I really think there are clear limits to the no limits partnership between China and Russia, but also in the energy sphere.
But that doesn't happen overnight. Still, you have to have infrastructure and that is not there yet. So I want to come back to this point of how much pain you are willing to endure, because I see a clear risk here that the ones who are asked to endure the most pain are actually the most vulnerable states. And Charles pointed out that as well globally, but even in Europe. So coming back to your point about how the public really takes this if the bills are going up. So how do you see the solution to this, really? Because if we have on one side the competition for the resources, then everybody's fighting for their own, raising energy bills and raising instability within our societies due to this. We can't ignore that. And climate targets or climate issues are off the picture then, because everybody's struggling to survive. So how to overcome that struggle, really?
Well, I think the Commission in Brussels has got some of the right ideas. Mr. Timmermans is thinking quite hard about this, and he's there has to be a so-called just transition. So he wants to set up a fund. Mm. It could be funded, the money from the ETS could go into
the REPowerEU, or
the CBAM could go into it. The Carbon Border Adjustment, and this fund would be targeted on helping the most vulnerable people who would suffer the most from increasing prices of energy. But how you actually do that in practice, I'm not sure. And how you sell it politically, I'm not sure either. The Commission's not very good at selling these things politically. But the thinking is going on in the Commission towards that end.
I just wanted to add one other dimension, because, you know, this is always an uncomfortable topic in a way, because in many ways, I hope that some of the scenarios I laid out are wrong. I mean, I wish there was feel-good environmentalism and feel-good energy options, and you kind of went in. And the fact is, I always try to meet with climate scientists, people who really understand the science, and we're cooking. I mean, it's violent weather has really hit, you know, various parts of the world, really made a dramatic difference in the United States. The we're seeing this. And it asked me, in terms of the public policy perspective, you know, if the scenario that I sort of think is likely to evolve is going to evolve, it changes from the investment of time and John Kerry running around the world and saying, let's do this. It reminds me of a Dr. Seuss cartoon, you know, we're here, let's do this, kind of moving along. And I feel very sorry for Secretary Kerry, because it's a tough time. He's now trying to go around the world, just getting people to kind of abide, nations to abide by what they promised in Glasgow. I don't think he's going to succeed, but I think that the choice is, what do we begin doing in terms of a massive other shift, which is mitigating what's likely to happen by way of climate change, right? So that's a huge, huge task, and I think we're going to end up there. So the conversation is while it's bleak, there are ways to begin thinking about some of these other dimensions that fit with it. And it's an unfortunate that the choices aren't easier, mm-hmm. and I didn't want to come into this today and be rosy, because I don't think it's a rosy picture. But I do think, particularly in the United States, that beginning to look at rising water, looking at heat and drought, looking at all these mitigation factors, is going to change the policy conversation to be less about climate change and just accept it's coming to a certain degree. You can still discuss your energy options, but it's naive not to think at this point that you're going to get major environmental impacts are going to require us to think about cities, climate protection, border protection, all very differently.
Yeah, will now turn to the audience. Does anybody think that it's rosy? So I would take a few of the questions if you have microphones here. Yes.
Thank you, Milena Lazarević, European Policy Center, Belgrade. I think that the discussion here today is very well illustrated in the movie Don't Look Up, if you've seen it. And it's a movie which speaks about, which tells a story about the imminent comet which is going to collide with the Earth, and then there is this movement which says Don't Look Up. So I think that at this point, it might be actually about getting people to look up. So who has the responsibility and how to do that? And another quick question, you haven't spoken about batteries and about this imminent dilemma between mining lithium and developing batteries. My own country, Serbia, saw a very major political crisis because of Rio Tinto's explorations and plans to develop mine lithium. What is the responsibility of? I mean, and we're speaking here about a Western company. I can only imagine what Chinese and other companies would be like. How do we get policymakers also to take responsibility and being very open, being very transparent about what is going on and what are the, let's say, costs and what are the consequences of some aspects of the green transition?
Very good. I would take a question from here. Microphone comes, and then we take one more, and then. Yes, okay.
Thanks very much, Boris Ruger, Munich Security Conference. I'm not an energy expert, but from what I can see, if we take out what Russia is delivering in terms of fossil fuels to the European Union, there's a gap that cannot be substituted. So I think this goes to Lykke's point about saving energy and energy efficiency. And I remember from the 70s as a kid when we had the situation in the early 70s and there was no, it was kind of, people couldn't drive on Sundays and these kinds of things. And there's really not much of that right now. We're sort of pretending as if we can carry on exactly as we did before. And this is an illusion, I think. And so I think there's a task here for political leaders to communicate that we're going to have to change a few things. I mean, there's a little bit of blood, sweat, and tears rhetoric that needs to be introduced.
Yeah, and we take the last from here, and then we go to the panel, and then, yes, please.
Natalie Tocci. So firstly, on the question of, you know, the losers from the transition, and I think, Charles, you're absolutely right. The Commission, in many respects, has this clear in its mind, Just Transition Fund, European Climate Fund. I think the problem is the magnitude that we're talking about. I mean, if we think that just one winter, last winter, my own country, Italy, spent on bills for the lower income households, 25 billion. And the European Climate Fund, the Social Climate Fund, we're talking about 160 billion for 27 countries for 7 years. Very clearly, we're talking about totally different magnitudes. And then if I may put to Geir, I mean, I think that indeed, you know, if we're looking at the Russia angle of this, quote unquote, only as us weaning off Russian oil and gas, in maybe, you know, end of the decade is a little bit maybe too pessimistic, but even if we're not as pessimistic and we say the next 3, 4, 5 years, well, in the next 3, 4, 5 years, then they will have connected up to China. So we will have become independent, but we will have done nothing to stop, you know, the financing of a war effort, which is why I think these escrow accounts, tariffs, or indeed an embargo is basically what we have to do yesterday.
So
can I just thank you? I want to respond to the "Don't Look Up." It's great. If you haven't seen the film, it's a great film. It's a great metaphor. But I would say that you know, the radicals right now, so the rarest breeds right now are those that are pragmatic deal makers in the center. And it was sort of a relief, I think, to that crowd that someone like Emmanuel Macron actually won in France, because it kind of gave them a sense, oh, there's, you know, some place in the world where someone who's willing to deal relatively in the middle was going to be okay. But in the U.S. political system right now, it is very, very hard to imagine the incentives to get the folks to look up, like, right? And I think that the stridency, it's what Francis Fukuyama told me the other day, democracies have become incredibly lazy, that a generation or two generations of people have lost any touch with the sacrifices that people made in very hard-won wars in the past, and that we become sloppy, lazy, and casual, and strident, and not empathetic with alternative views within our societies and democracies, and that seeing Ukraine and the fight there has helped at least some see someone actually fighting for their nation and fighting for their democracy, fighting for their rights and sovereignty. But in my book, I know that most Americans, and I hate to say this, and I know many of you will disagree, while they know Ukraine matters, it matters in a casual, distant way. It's really not impacting them, and it can be ignored. And I believe that what will happen eventually in the U.S. is that we will eventually drift into a very significant, high-scale, real-world crisis at some point. I can't tell you what it is, or we're going to have a moment where the United States has a Suez crisis moment, and all of a sudden it's, you know, remember, power, like oil prices and gas prices, are a function of future expectations. Right now, China's doing better in the future expectation department than the United States is. So when you're in that moment where all of a sudden, remember, the mystique of a superpower is based on everybody believing that you can invent yourself and reinvent yourself over and over and over again. If that's diminished, then you'll have a staggering collapse of the perception of America's ability to do things. That is going to be very late in the process, and you can't reinvent mystique overnight. So this question, if you framed it just on this, and I'll stop, is an important one. But we have become a reactive country. I don't see a Dean Acheson. I don't see a new world of kind of global architecture builders coming out of the Biden administration. They're chasing the tail of events. Mm. And as long as we're in that period of time, that tension between those who look up and those don't is going to remain very real and very. So that's what makes me a pessimist in these times.
Okay. Well, does that go for the states as well and the cities and so forth? That you serve to be part of the debate about United States.
Don't ask Steve. He will be really long, and then nobody else gets to speak. So,
okay. Let me respond briefly to the lady from Belgrade. Firstly, on lithium itself. Sorry. I mean, Chile has a lot of lithium. And the EU has a trade agreement with Chile that's being negotiated, but the French have vetoed it to protect their farmers. Let's hope the one consequence of Macron's election victory is he'll be a little bit softer on some of these trade agreements than he was going to be. I mean, I think that there's a bit more broadly, there's a lesson to be learned from this energy dependency on Russia. We shouldn't become dependent on any country for important strategic supplies.
Exactly. That's true.
But we are so dependent on China in so many ways.
Yeah.
I mean, the German economy is, the German car industry does depend on China. 50% of VW's sales are in China. And the CEO of VW a little while ago said he hadn't heard about anything bad happening in Xinjiang, and he didn't have time to read about it. I mean, this is awful. I think, you know, the dependency of Germany on China is worrying. The dependency of us all in Europe on rare earths from China is worrying. We don't like to process rare earths in Europe because it's very dirty and messy. But I think perhaps we should. Maybe the French are right. Maybe Macron is right that strategic autonomy means shortening supply chains, doing more of the processing within Europe. It may be messy, but perhaps we should do it that way. I'm very worried about the dependency on China in the long run.
Mm. Mm.
Yeah, but I guess then hopefully you could also look into free trade agreements, as you mentioned, with Chile, but you could also look into the one with Canada, right? I mean, last time I checked, Germany still hasn't been able to ratify that CETA agreement. I mean, but now Germany is importing gas from Qatar. I mean, that seems a bit of a paradoxical situation there. So, but obviously the point, energy savings, just thank you for supporting my point. I mean, you should have a short-term package, obviously. I mean, with regards to heating system at home. I mean, you should also have, I mean, with regards to driving, I mean, what do you say in Germany? Freie Fahrt für freie Bürger may be a bit difficult. Maybe you'd have to say you can't drive 130 kilometers an hour and so forth. But then obviously also the energy efficiency directive would have to be substrengthened.
But the energy savings, I mean, also the solidarity between the countries, because if it is so that, you know, German factories are functioning like full scale and Bulgarian homes are cold, it's not fair, really.
Exactly.
So, and what I'm afraid of is that when everybody starts to, you know, think about their own country, then we end up with this, and this is bad for the overall security of the region. Geir.
No, just on this energy savings issue, which I think is a very important one, and it underlines that in order to deal with the crisis we're confronted with now, you need to look both at the supply side and the demand side. Mm. And that's, I think, very important. Having said that, we've talked about energy efficiency for decades, and we've always said that it's the low-hanging fruit, and somehow we never seem to fully be able to pick it. And then one point on to Natalie's question about, or comment about pipeline connections between Russia and China. I think we will have a very interesting test of the Sino-Russian energy relationship now. There is no doubt that the Chinese would like to see a Power of Siberia 2 pipeline, 50 BCM annually, being built. Mm. The question is, if the Russians aren't able to build it due to sanctions, would the Chinese then be willing to step in and co-finance it? There I have my doubts. Mm. I think there are clear limits to how far the Chinese would go engaging in sanctions busting activity, because they know that if they engage in financial and technological backfill, what will happen is that they risk secondary sanctions.
Yeah.
So the type of sanctions busting that the Chinese are likely to engage in will be covert, small scale, and it will probably involve very marginal Chinese economic actors.
Okay, so we take three more questions. Gentlemen here, then gentlemen here, and gentlemen in the back. So here. Yes. If you can be short, then we can take more.
Okay, I'll try to be short. Guys, especially this is for Steve and for Geir. The question whether renewables are really cheap and so forth, but there's a related question, is what you can do with renewables, because the cost going up as you have to change the whole grid and storage and so forth. So in Germany, the 8th monitoring report last year or so ago said it's not going to be possible to, you know, take care of Germany's needs in the future with renewables alone, that they have to start taking them from other countries and somehow get the credits back home, or the investment will never happen. So it's not just, I mean, when Baerbock went to Ukraine just before the war began, I mean, this had been going on for some months, and Ukrainians were quite ticked off talking about, you know, German colonial attitude, demanding that they produce hydrogen and send it through the pipelines in the future. And number two, she wanted a photo op at a solar plant, right? But here's another thing I think you guys might know something about. You mentioned about wind. I see from the IEA data, this is a few years ago I looked at this, that Germany, for example, Germany's wind, Americans had an 80% higher capacity factor in wind. And I looked into it. It's not just because there's more wind. So I asked the guys at the IEA, because it's their data, and they said, oh, yeah, and by the way, it's 60% better than the EU on average. This is devastating. You know, if that was auto industry. So I know you guys own wind farms. So I'm just curious, this aspect of whether this is, mm-hmm. how efficient this is being done.
Okay, thank you. Here.
Kopogan, International Criminal Court. My question is actually not, it's about the, we're talking about energy and possibilities, and somehow, whenever you read this topic, very rarely anybody mentions the fact that actually the biggest natural gas fields in Europe, in the world perhaps, actually are in the EU territory. And it's an Aphrodite gas field off coast of Cyprus. And it's discovered 10 years ago, I think last week, the Cypriot Minister of Energy were saying that they start kind of producing there. Maybe it's time now to, countries like Germany, maybe Hungary, who are really dependent on Russian gas, to talk to the Cypriots, talk to the Turks, Lebanon, Egypt, Israel, and try to use this gas field, because my understanding is it's one of the biggest gas fields in the world, and just to work on it, US, UK, of course, as well, and EU Commission, of course, as well, should go. I'm just wondering, who can answer it, why we are not talking about Aphrodite gas field, and what possibility there could be as well.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Please.
Alan Riley, Atlantic Council. My first thing is, Prime Minister, I totally agree with you. The way forward is to focus on some form of tariff or war levy to bring strip them of the revenues today, rather than wait to have full embargo to be in place.
So we will do a tax, taxing those who attack other countries. And
yes. And the point about it is that what you said, 40%, that was true when the war started, but because of sanctions and everything else. Probably now the Russian economy is 70-80% dependent on its revenues. So we actually have them where we want them, and we can let them keep some of it, but we can strip them of the rest so they can't wage war. Mm-hmm. So that's just, so I totally support your point. My more immediate question is to Geir, really. One of the things that's happened with this whole central issue of the extent to which European consumers have been pushed into fuel poverty as a result of Gazprom effectively gearing up the Europeans for the prospect of war by massively increasing energy prices. And this is what they did. You know, normally, you have three things. You have Gazprom over 20 years, it would first of all provide gas under long-term supply contract, then provide gas to spot market, then provide gas to refill. And basically, from the spring of 2021, it only provided gas under long-term supply contracts, and that's what sent the prices up. And they did that to soften us up, to prepare us for war, to hope that when they launched their attacks on Ukraine, they wouldn't actually we wouldn't actually respond and assist Ukraine. So if we've got this fuel poverty caused by this co-belligerent war action by Russia and by Gazprom, surely we should also be prepared to take action against Russia and ensure that we actually make them pay for this financially and recompensate our consumers. Mm. And so that's the point I would make. And I think there is a very strong argument to doing. We can actually identify and trace that, because everything that happened in the last from spring 2021 was completely, it's not commercial, and it never ever happened before. Mm. We have, anyhow.
Yes, thank you. So who wants to go first? Geir.
Maybe just a brief comment to Cyprus and the Eastern Mediterranean, because we've been looking at this for the last decade or so. And the biggest bottleneck to developing the resources in the Eastern Med is the Cyprus conflict. And as long as the Cyprus conflict remains deadlocked, there are going to be limited options to bring hydrocarbons from the Eastern Med to Europe. Probably the best option right now would be for Israel, which has two fields in production already and may have some surplus gas, to bring that gas down to Egypt through pipeline and have the Egyptians turn it into liquefied natural gas. That sounds complicated, that sounds convoluted, but it may actually be the cheapest way of getting any kind of gas from the Eastern Med to world markets in a relatively short period of time. Mm. I think that all the other pipeline options that have been tried have all failed because of a lack of progress on solving the fundamental issues around Cyprus. Mm. And here, energy is a hostage to geopolitics.
Mm-hmm. And what's the time frame of that, from an optimistic perspective?
A resolution to the Cyprus conflict?
No.
two centuries.
Israel, Egypt.
Yeah, OK.
No, it could be done, provided there is will on both sides. It could be done. There is an existing pipeline that goes through the Sinai, so it's not the best geopolitical environment, security environment. But there is infrastructure that could make this possible. But we are talking about limited amounts of gas. But of course, at this particular point in time, when Europe is looking for all marginal supplies, it could add.
Okay.
No. Yes.
What I would just say to our friend from the International Criminal Court, because, you know, I think like many of you, I hang out at conferences like this. I think it's a great question. I think it comes up, it may not have come up today, but it comes up a lot more than you'd think. And I think one of the interesting questions is Turkey. And Turkey and Erdogan are the most, you know, among the most interesting geostrategic disruptors out there. And that worries me about Cyprus and this unresolved. But it comes up a lot. It's just nobody knows how to get the Rubik's Cube right. But and I think... You know, that Turkey has ambitions in that with that asset that is, you know, as you described, the Cyprus thinks it is, and you know, I think it's going to create an interesting scramble. So it comes up. Just very quickly, I'm not an expert on capacity, wind capacity, but I'll tell you that I am fascinated by the politics of this, and I'm also fascinated by the fact that at least the U.S. side of production of wind turbines is concerned that it may lose competitiveness down the road and that see that industry, when it's such an important industry, wiped out because of credits as opposed to need, and that Europe and China may end up becoming the big beneficiaries on production. What I'll say is the politics, I'm fascinated by this guy, Kevin Cramer. You know, I know that you may not all know American politics. Kevin Cramer is a senator from North Dakota. And North Dakota has been turned into a gas production powerhouse. But also turns out he's got in his state, which he has the single, big state, they make GE wind turbines. And I had him in a conversation the other day, and I had dinner with Senator Lindsey Graham, who is a better known senator. And Senator Lindsey Graham said, yeah, Kevin Cramer's a great guy. He's a right-wing fanatic nut on everything but climate and energy issues because of this issue. Now, I didn't know that. I don't think most of the world does. But there are opportunities there with people across these political lines in the U.S. that wish a lot of our friends, and I know many of you have, that you begin finding ways for that to become something where, to get back to our friend on Don't Look Up, we actually have someone who's of the other area who's actually willing to put a little spotlight on the fact that renewables mattered in North Dakota.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Okay?
That's fascinating.
Yes.
Well, I've got a kind of concluding comment, but shall I save that for later? Because you want to take some more questions first.
No.
We have six minutes,
so it is now. Speak now or
remain
silent. Of the Cyprus question.
Well, nobody's mentioned Emmanuel Macron so far in this conversation.
I did.
You did.
Okay. Well, slightly, but I think let's not
Emmanuel
forget
Macron.
In his comments recently about a European political community, when he revived the old Mitterrand idea of a confederation, he did talk about this being something that should cover energy. Mm. I think he's quite right that Europe does need to be more strategic about energy, and I think that common purchasing of gas, common storage facilities, better interconnectors, these are all things that could be part of such an eventuality. And I think that it's very important for countries like Ukraine and Britain that are outside the EU and perhaps need to think about joining this political community when they can. But one caveat, I think I'm rather a fan of this idea, but my worry is he's talking about changing the treaties. And so, well, as the Prime Minister knows better than I do, a lot of member states do not want to change the treaties in a hurry, because last time we changed the treaties in the EU, it took about 10 years and lots of referendums and lots of hassle. And this, such a distraction would take us away from the important task of working about how we reduce our energy dependency on Russia and other important tasks.
Coming to just your point, what Emmanuel Macron always talks about is autonomy of this, autonomy, food autonomy, this. And I feel, listening and looking into the details, is actually protectionism in disguise. So it is keeping all the others out so that, you know, we have the autonomy. But that was before the war, really. So maybe now it is a different situation. But it depends whether we are talking about autonomy of the region or everybody, and if we are talking about the region, aren't we creating, you know, additional problems? Africa, for example, migration pressure from there, because we are trying to keep them out of, you know, all these things so that we can have the autonomy. But that's a totally different and much broader discussion. But we have to be, I mean, I'm very supportive of market economy, and therefore I'm very allergic to
I think on energy he's right. We do need to be autonomous on energy in Europe.
No, true. But it comes back to the interconnections that we have between each other, between the friends, really, and how we use them. So this is for the region and not for every separate country. And energy, I agree, it's a bit different issue.
It's a very tweetable moment, in case of you were tweeting. That was probably the most tweetable comment in the whole panel discussion.
Yeah, that's going to get me into trouble.
Geir
wanted to come.
Just one point on Turkey, which I think is important. I mean, we've been talking about the energy decoupling, but it's energy decoupling between the EU and Russia. It is not with the Balkans and Russia. And it is certainly not with Turkey and Russia, because both Blue Stream and Turk Stream will continue to play an important role, both for Russia and for these parts of Europe and Turkey. So I think that's important to keep in mind. If I may end on one final thought, which I think we should consider as one of the dilemmas that we are confronting, as we are both trying to solve a short-term crisis and a longer term, is what does Germany say when Qatar says, yes, we will be willing to provide you with LNG, but we want a long-term contract that runs to 2040.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Exactly.
Otherwise, it doesn't make sense for us to do it.
They won't boycott the World Cup in Qatar.
Exactly. But that's the kind of challenges, and that's the kind of dilemmas that policymakers will be confronted with, because you then risk going beyond the life of fossil fuels that you are prepared to, but you may not have a choice. And how do you strike that balance? I think that's going to be a key issue to deal with, both the security of supply issue and of course addressing climate concerns. And it locks you in.
It locks you in.
And from an investor perspective, what you don't want to do is being locked in and ending up with a stranded asset.
It's true, but this is a very valid point that you're making. But on the other side, it is also in terms of the geopolitics, what kind of decisions we are making. For example, is the independence of Russian gas and oil, for how long it is planned, really? Is it indefinitely? And then if it is indefinitely, then the investors can also make investments to, you know, LNG, other sources of energy. When it's not indefinite, and knowing that, you know, Russian gas is cheaper, the pipeline gas is cheaper, and there is still a threat in the air that, you know, if this all sorts out, then we go back to business as usual, then nobody makes the investments to the sectors that we really need investments to. So having geopolitical decisions and really sticking to them, I think it's important. But on the other side, it is always our people who is asking later on. We make the investments to LNG, for example, then business as usual continues, and then everybody's like, why did you spend all that taxpayers' money on that alternative source, which is much more expensive? But with that positive note, no solutions and no quick solutions here. There wasn't actually many questions were not answered. I noticed that as well, but
Great share.
It is how it is.
We need more lithium.
That was a bad question.
Okay.